We have 14-year-olds taking up arms, shooting up schools because they feel gay, and people are being bullied. They're bullying him because he's gay. We have kids that are struggling with depression. I see every single day. They're cutting themselves. They're slicing themselves in the neck. They're taking razors into their head. I saw this just a couple days ago. Why? We can't really arrive at any conclusion. We say these big little phrases, they're depressed, they're anxious, they're dealing with anxiety, they're dealing with this sort of thing, their family system is bad. Then going off of that note, where are their parents? That's our first question. What is going on at home? What is going wrong at home is the real question. So to tell us about this, someone that is time tested in his family life, someone that is time tested in raising children, someone that is time tested in raising our children even on our behalf, we have Dr. Masada to discuss this.
Jazakallah khair.
له الملك وله الحمد وهو على كل شيء قدير. So before we start, I will ask a very simple question. If I will ask the people here, why the Muslim Ummah is weak and lazy? What will be the answer? You'll find most of the people will say, Ya Akhi, because we don't have enough technology. This is a normal question. If you go to any country, they will tell you, oh, you live in the United States? Oh, Ya Akhi, they give you the food for free, they show your food. Huh? Every night they tell you the night story. So they don't know how much the people work here. So tell them, no, this is the wrong answer. The Ummah is weak and lazy because we take ourselves away from our deen and sharia. That's the main problem. Because if you look in the old days, I'm not going to say that Muslim, they have the best weapon and so, no. But they have the quwwat iman. They have the iman. So they always are victory for them. So now the question, why we as a Muslim always follow the kuffar? This was mentioned to us 1,446 years ago by our Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wassalam. What he said, لَتَتَّبَعَنَّ سُنَنَ الْأَوَّلِينَ شِبْرًا بِشِبْرًا وَذِرَاعًا بِذِرَاعًا حَتَّى لَوْ دَخَلُوا جُحْرَ دَبٍ طَبَعْتُمُوهُمْ فَقَالَ الصَّحَابَةَ أَهُمُ الْيَهُودُ وَالنَّصَارَى قَالَ فَمَنْ Rasulullah said, you will follow the steps of the kuffar, inch by inch. Even if they will enter a leather hole, you will go after them. So the Sahaba told him, do you mean Yahud and the Nasara? He said, whom else? It's true, Yahi. Look what they do to your children. I don't know. You find, cut the hair from the side, they cut it. Make the pants go down your, you do it, right? Tell the girl, short skirt, they do it. Long skirt, they do it. No sleeve, they do it. Every step the kuffar do, we follow them. Do you know why Rasulullah especially chose the word dab? Dab is a lizard. And he is, you know, he lives in a very dark hole and a very bad smell. But still we'll go after them. This is why Umar ibn al-Khattab, he said, قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ مَنْ تَشَبَّهَ بِقَوْمٍ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ He who imitates any people in their actions is considered to be one of them. So all the action which you do as a Muslim, and you're supposed to be proud of a Muslim, that you are a Muslim. Because what we say, Allah gives this dunya to everyone. Did Allah stop the air from kuffar? No. But he gives the deen, the Islam, to the chosen one which we are. This is a bless from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now how we can safeguard our family? Wallahi, it is mentioned in the Quran and in the Sunnah of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. And I hope parents and youth listen very carefully. I will ask you after I done. What Allah said? Allah said in the Quran, Ya ayyuha an-nas, inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha, wa ja'alnakum shu'uban wa qabaila lita'arafu. Inna akramakum 'inda Allahi atqakum. Allah said, we created you from male and female, and we let you know each other. The best of you in the sight of Allah is the one which have the more taqwa. Not the rich, not the white, not the black, not the red, not the yellow, not the English speaker, not the PhD. Inna akramakum 'inda Allahi atqakum. So you have to plant this in your children's heart. Inna akramakum 'inda Allahi atqakum. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us something which is very important. It's a warning. قال الله تعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا قوا أنفسكم وأهليكم نارا وقودها الناس والحجارة. Allah said, oh, you believe, protect yourself and your family from a hellfire. What do you mean protect yourself and your family? So Muhammad came and said, he said, كلكم راع وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيته. Every one of you is shepherd and you are responsible for your flocks. خلاص, it is your responsibility and your responsibility as a mother and your responsibility as a father and my responsibility as a teacher to teach you how you suppose really to live your life. A man came to Umar ibn al-Khattab. This would be the entry. And then he told him, you know Umar, huh? He's always very hard. Ya Khalifat Rasulullah, my son disobey me. Yes. Umar told, you know, the people, go bring his son. They went running, bring the son. Then he told him, why you disobey your father? So the son told him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, is the children have rights over their parents? Very valid question. Then he told him, yes. Then he told him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, tell me what it is. Then he told him, number one, to choose, listen, a good wife. To choose a good wife. Number two, choose a good name for him. And number three, teach him Quran and Sunnah. That's it, it's easy. So the son told him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, my father choose a wife, doesn't have any idea about the deen, about Islam. And number two, he choose for me a name which I am shy when they call me with it. And number three, he didn't teach me any of the Quran. So Amir al-Mu'mineen looked to the man and told him, out! You are undutiful to your son. It's not him. So now you are for the people that didn't marry or the parents. When you choose a wife for your kid or you choose a wife for yourself, choose the one which came in the hadith. What Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, تُنْكَحَ الْمَرْأَةُ لِأَرْبَعَ. You marry the woman for four things. Number one, لِحَسَبِهَا, her lineage. Number two, لِمَالِهَا, her wealth. Number three, لجمالها her beauty. Number four لدينها فظفر بذات الدين. Pick up the one which have دين تربت يداك. You will be blessed. This is the criteria. This is Muhammad our prophet. Either we are Muslim or we are not. But what is happening? You find that I just want, يعني there is an issue really, and I was debating to say it or no, but I will. You like it or not? The people come to the foreign country. You come down of the aeroplane. Then you look, subhanallah, blonde hair, huh? Green eyes, huh? Short skirt. And they are, khalas, their brain went crazy. Wallahi, wallahi. And then if you are here to study and then you go to college, especially college, because I work, you know, as a professor, so for how long? And then you start to see the beauty. And then you compare it between here and your country. So, Ya Rabbi, what we have in our country. But you don't know where you are going. So what's happening? Of course, there is the opposite also happened. So you find the kid, khalas, his brain is frozen. He wants to marry an American woman. And then when you tell him, Ya Akhi, you have a lot of nice Muslim women. He said, but you know, look, imagine my children, how they looks like, right? So he married an American woman. And then he said, when he talked to him, Ya Akhi, why didn't you marry a Muslim woman? He said, no, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you can marry from Kitabiyya, either Christian or Jew. Then I tell him, Ya Akhi, during this time, Islam was dominating. The Sharia is dominating. And we need, so the Christian and Jew to marry Muslims so they come to Islam. And they have to be Muslim. But now we are ruled by the Christian and Jew Sharia, right? So one day, if the woman changed her mind, she go to court and say, this man have weapon under the bed. He's a terrorist, yes? So court, and they say, give her the children, yes? And then the children will be Christian. And in the hereafter, when you stand in front of Allah, your child will say, nafsi, nafsi. When Allah tell him, why you are Christian, abuk Muslim? Then he say, wallahi, this is my father, ask him. So when Allah ask him, he will tell him, I was trying to make her enter Islam, but she didn't listen. And then she said, you know, I'm Christian, but because I love you, I will follow Islam teaching. I know. In Chicago, wallahi a case. And the man came and say, I marry one, it came from Eastern Europe. But she's a Christian and he's a Muslim. Now the children, she never embraced Islam. Her son have some problem, mental problem. You know what she do to let him calm down? She gave him vodka. Vodka! And the father can do nothing. And then she cook pork, she drink, and of course the children. When I talk to them, you don't understand what they are. They are not Christian, they are not Muslim, they are nothing. And this is how the ummah started to go down. Because if you don't from the beginning have the key of the family to adjust the family, This is your problem, man. This is your problem. Not only that, but Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also said that for the man, he said, whoever anyone come to you and you like his manners and his behavior, let him marry your daughter. He didn't say بقى how much he has in the bank, what type of his car, which job, and this is what they do now. How much dowry you have to pay, so nobody married. In Egypt, they have now 60% divorce. Why do you find the people when they marry, mashallah, they buy furniture, they pay dowry, and then they have a nice house. 4-5 months, starts the problem. Both of them work, your money, my money, then they start to fight, and then they divorce. As they didn't know that, إِنَّ أَبْغَدَ الْحَلَالِ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الطَّلَاقِ. Allah doesn't like talaq, because the children will go and Allah nowhere. So this is why Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, ما استفاد المؤمن بعد تقوى الله خيرا من زوجة صالحة إن أمرها أطاعت وإن نظر إليها سرت وإن أقسم عليها أبرت وإن غاب عنها نصحته أو حفظته في نفسها وماله. طبعا how many people know عربي؟ ما شاء الله ما شاء الله. I just want to say Arabic is a language of Quran. Huh? But for you, if you forget. Rasulullah said, the believer does not gain anything better after fearing Allah than a right wife. If he orders her, she obeys him. If she looks at her, she pleases him. And if he is away from her, she advises him and protects him in herself and his wealth. This is a good wife. Alhamdulillah, Allah gave me a very good wife, Allah. I work at Cornell and it was a competition, I don't really lie. Sometimes I sleep in the lab for 3 days. It's biology. And wallahi, she take a very good care of my children. May Allah reward her. Wallahi, may Allah reward her. She raised them. يعني they were in the preliminary school and they have hijab. And this is the wife. This is what you, new generation, need. This will let the ummah continue. Let us, instead of the Jew beating Gaza and nobody do something, we let those people to say, we need Khilafah. But all of us, what we do? Everyone, I'm sure in this room, his father or his mother want him to be a physician. Yes? And all of you, subhanallah, wallahi, when you ask them, okay, what is your son doing? Oh, he's a hafiz. MashaAllah. He's a hafiz? Yes. Okay. Where is he? He's coming and then he lead us in Taraweeh. MashaAllah. So I ask the hafiz one question about one, you know, ayah in the Quran. Can you tell me what's the meaning? He say, I don't know. What do you mean you don't know? Now, if you are a hafiz and then you give classes to some children and then a child tell you, Ya Sheikh, Ya Hafiz, tell me what this mean. You will tell him, I don't know. So what's the beauty of the Quran? Umar ibn al-Khattab memorized Surah Al-Baqarah in 10 years. So they ask him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, Umar ibn al-Khattab is smart. Why it take from you this long time? He said, because every ayah I read, I understand, and I use it in my life. ألف لام ميم ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين. This book is a guidance. How is a guidance if you don't understand it? Can you be a physician and you don't understand what each really drug do? You can't. Yes? Can I be a biologist working cancer research and I don't know what really every receptor do? I can't. So the whole question is, we have a poet, his name Hafiz Ibrahim in Egypt. What he said, this is to show how the mother is important. He said, Al-ummu madrasatun, idha a'adattuha, a'adattu sha'ban tayyiba al-a'raqi. The mother is a school. If you prepare the mother good and well, it will give you a very well nation. He didn't say the father, yeah. He didn't say, and I'm a father. He didn't say a father. Because really the mother, she spent with her children, much longer than the father. She teaches them everything if she is good. So now if you want to have a peace of mind, always remember what Allah said. وَلَا تَنْكِحُ الْمُشْرِكَاتِ حَتَّى يُؤْمِنُ وَلَآمَّةٌ مُؤْمِنَةٌ خَيْرٌ مِّنْ مُشْرِكَةٍ وَلَوْ أَعْجَبَتْكُمْ وَلَا تُنْكِحُ الْمُشْرِكِينَ حَتَّى يُؤْمِنُ وَلَعَبْدٌ مُؤْمِنٌ خَيْرٌ مِّنْ مُشْرِكٌ وَلَوْ أَعْجَبَكُمْ. Don't marry a kafira even if you like her. Because a slave Muslim is better for you. And the opposite. Don't give your daughter to a mushrik man because a slave man Muslim is better for your daughter. This is the Quran. I'm not bringing it from myself. This is the Quran. This is what I saw in Chicago. A lot of problems. Sometimes people, wallahi, call and say, Ya Sheikh, anyway, I'm not Sheikh, yani, I'm Sheikh by age. Ya Sheikh, can I marry George? So I say, oh, he told me that after marriage he will yani, embrace Islam. No, sister, are you sure? Okay, I will, in the beginning, I'll just go and marry him in the masjid. I told her, okay, when you marry in the masjid, are you sure that if he divorces you, you will get everything back from him? I tell them first go and do your marriage in the city to be sure that you have a document in your hand. Because masjid doesn't give you a document to go to court. But this can happen. Why? Because there is no Islamic education. There is no tarbiyah in the house. Then mother and father, they don't teach their children how to choose a wife and how to choose a husband. Second one, I want to go. I'm okay. The second one, which is choose a name. يا أخي سبحان الله. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم سموا أبناءكم بأسماء الأنبياء. Name your children with the name of أنبياء. And the best name on the sight of Allah is عبد الرحمن and عبد القادر أعتقد and عبد الله. And insist to your child in school they have to call you عبد الله and عبد الرحمن. You know what happened in Ithaca? It is in New York. So I was a couple of years ago in the masjid. So I heard kids calling another kid Lala, Lala. So I told him, come, yakhi. What is Lala mean? He told me, no. Ammu, my name is Abdullah. I told him, your name is Abdullah. And the Muslim telling you Lala, he says, this is the way which they call me in school. Yakhi, in school, your name is Abdullah. My last name is Abdul Ghani. When I was working at Cornell, they have to say Abdul Ghani. I cannot tell them to tell me Lala or Lilla. No. is my name and I'm proud of it. So you have to tell your child, be proud of your name and use it and don't tell anybody to give you a nickname. And also there is a lot of names. Reyes, Omar, there is Othman, all these beautiful names. There is Khadija, there is, you know, Fatima, all these beautiful names. Why we name them Elsie? What is Elsie, akhi? Wallahi, I hear name Elsie. What is Elsie? You have a beautiful Islamic name. When you call the Islamic name, so the people know she is a Muslim. They don't have to ask her, huh? If somebody say, Mahmoud, he will never come and tell you, are you Muslim? No, my name is Mahmoud or Muhammad. I saw a name in Chicago, which is weird. A man named Mark Muhammad. Wallahi, he's a real estate. You find, what is Mark Muhammad? What does this tell you? Then Mr. Mark, I mean Mr. Muhammad, Mark Ahmed, not Muhammad. Mr. Ahmed married a Christian woman. And then she make her son Christian. And she named him Mark. Now imagine when you hear Mark Ahmed, is this fit, Yachi, in any one of us? It doesn't fit. But still, she took one, a precious one from Islam, make him believe in three things in one. Why? Because the father didn't think properly. And we think it's easy. Oh, I will marry her, but wallahi, I will later enter Islam. I will make her يعني, love Islam and. And she did for him the opposite. And this is our problem. This is why the ummah is going down. And then when you ask, how much really you did with your children as education. I am sure everybody in this room, I'm a challenge you guys. How much time you spend with your children? This is a challenge. And don't lie because Allah knows better. How much time? Huh? Either you are working and your husband working, yes? And then you don't spend any time to teach your children the true Islam and how to love their ummah. Not only that, but the worst is when you give your children a cell phone and tell them, be quiet, I want to sleep. Yes? Because I'm working all night, I can't. And then your child opens the cell phone and Allah a'lam. Allah knows better what he is watching. Do you guys know what he is watching? No. Because you are snoring because you are going at night to work. Or you are going in the early morning. Is this really what Allah asks us? قو أنفسكم وأهليكم نارا وقودها الناس والحجارة. Protect yourself and your family. Is this what we do? How much of you, how many of you teach the children the good history of Muslim? Ya akhi, we ruled 3/4 of the world. How many of you talk about Ottoman Empire with your children? Who? Instead of all this movie by the West, showing Spider-Man and the other guy flying, I don't know. Yeah, Superman. And you sit, let them sit and watch it. You let them sit and watch cartoon and you don't know, do you know that some of these cartoons really talking about gay? Wallahi, you have to wake up. Before it's too late, it's already too late. What I'm saying is before too late. خلاص. We lost our dignity. You find one small strip beating day and night and Muslim, mashallah. You know what Muslim did? But there is a brother here from Saudi Arabia. I don't want him to be upset. Muslim in Riyadh, they make everyday party. They bring naked women to dance. And their brother and sister are killed. Is this our Islam? And again, when we go, we say, Wallahi, this is not Islam. This is not the family. There is no teaching. In any Arab country or any Muslim country for Islam like that. What Rasulullah said, Al-Muslimu lil-Muslimi kal-bunyan yashiddu ba'duhu ba'dan. Muslim for Muslim as a building, brackets, side by side to support him. Not to humiliate him. So when we wake up, when will we start to teach our children Quran and Sunnah? When will we start? You know what they said to the children? They said, oh, don't talk to them. They are teenage. What is mean teenage, yakhi? Until what, 26 years old, he's a teenage? Did they know that if you teach them Islamic history, I just will give you an example. Osama ibn Zayd, he was 17 years old. Huh? 17 years old. And he was ahead of the army and under his command, Abu Bakr and Umar. 17 years old, yakhi. Who is 17 years old here can do that? He tell you, no, I am shy. Huh? Right? I can't be يعني, a leader of an army. And then you find him, he wearing a jeans. And on these jeans, wallahi, I don't know why they pay money. A lot of space is showing his leg. Ya Ibni, so why you pay money? And I heard this is cost more than the normal jeans. I told him, okay, buy one and I will cut it for you. It will be cheaper. And the people, the parents, where is the parents? They saw the children and they says, okay. What is okay, akhi? And during the time when the children, then they have to show their underpants. You find a lot of Muslim. He go in sujood, you see everything, subhanallah. Is this what Rasulullah said to pray? No. I'm sorry to say, but we have to wake up. Zayd ibn Thabit, he was 13 years old. Listen, wallahi, 13 years old. Rasulullah ordered him to memorize the Hebrew language and Syriac language, which was used in Syria and Sham. And he memorized them better than, you know, the people. And then he was the translator of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. 13 years old. But what we do here when we come? I'll tell you something very funny. You find the Arab when they come here. The Arab, I'm Arab, yani. They start to talk to their children in English. And then when they go to visit Egypt, they talk only in English with the children. And they say, oh, they don't know Arabic. They forget Arabic. And they are proud. Proud of what, yakhi? Proud because your child lost his language of Quran? Why? Why? What's the benefit of that? And he's proud. Wallahi. One time I was in a house of a professor at Cornell. He's a Muslim. And then he have a son. I think it was 16, 17. So I told him, okay, is your son know Quran? He said, no, yakhi, don't push him. 17 years old, I don't push him. So when we push him? When will he start to push him to know the language of his deen? Not only that, but think about it. If you are here, not good in Quran. So let's suppose that your parents teach you 50%. So how much you teach your children? How much? From 0 to 20, maximum of 10. So now the question, when you die, how much your children will teach their children? Zero. And then Islam will disappear. Because of you, or of me, of you, and of you. And of course, the mothers are, they have the big responsibilities. Is this what we need? Is this what we ordered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Is this Allah said that let Islam to be, you know, done from the United States because you guys are very busy driving Uber or working day and night to put bread on the table? Is this what Allah asked us? Is Muhammad alayhi salatu wassalam, he was looking to how much food he put in his table? La wallah. The hadith an Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, she was talking to her nephew, and then she told him, wallahi, the houses of Rasulullah stay for 2 months and 3 moon with no food, or really is no fire in the house. If you don't light a fire in your house, can you cook? No. Then Prophet Muhammad, which he's supposed to get whatever he wants, stay for 2 months without food. So her nephew told her, so what you guys ate? He said, al-aswadan, al-ma'u wa-tamr. We drink water and then we eat يعني the cheapest of the dates. And sometimes, you know, some friend of Sayyidina Muhammad, they have milking animal, they send to him some milk so we can drink. Prophet Muhammad, if you tell to Medina, collect all the food you have, bring it to me, nobody would say no. But this is the way which he lived. He lived for what? He lived for the da'wah. He lived to be sure when he die, Islam spread, and Islam will stay inshallah forever. Why? Because the only way, we don't have a choice, yakhi. In the hereafter, either Jannah or Nar, either paradise or hellfire. There is no nothing in between. So did we think about that? Do we think that we have to protect our children from hellfire? So the only way to do that, then you have to work hard and very hard. And be sure when you die and stand in the hereafter, your children will not tell Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Rabbi, ask him. He didn't teach me any things like the child which he gave to Umar ibn al-Khattab. We done? أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه. And I hope really what I said went to your heart and your brain. جزاكم الله خير.